Thank you. As always, it's a pleasure to be here. We've moved from one public health disaster to the next, so from air pollution to drinking water and sanitation. I've been following rural sanitation policy for many years, primarily because of a chance shift in my early career when I was at the World Bank. I ended up spending a year at the Water and Sanitation Program, and all my colleagues thought it was perfectly all right to talk about open defecation as you were about to grab lunch. And in those days, about a decade ago, one of the primary complaints of anybody that was working on sanitation policy was that it's such an unglamorous issue. It has absolutely no political capital, as a consequence of which nobody is interested and no politician is willing to really take this up in a big way and make it happen. And that for about a decade ago was the primary reason why sanitation remained at the periphery of any discussion on public policy. In 2014, that seemed to have changed quite substantively. Through the election and post the election, our current Prime Minister seemed to have gone out of his way to risk his political capital on achieving total sanitation. More interestingly, the rhetoric around sanitation too seemed to have shifted quite significantly in the immediate post-2014 conversation around sanitation, which was that there appeared to be a general consensus. One of the big policy struggles up until that point was to convince the world at large that the problem of sanitation can't be solved simply by building toilets, that the reason why we have a serious sanitation problem in India is not because people don't have money to construct toilets, it's about something far more complicated, which in government parlance has sort of been reduced to some notion of something called behavior change, and those two words now get bandied about quite a bit. But there seemed to have been in 2014 a large scale policy acknowledgement that the heart of the problem was behavior change. And on the 2nd of October 2014, when the Prime Minister launched the Swacch Bharat Mission with in his typical style of much hoopla, with lots of photographs and lots of media moments, it seemed to be a very interesting tipping point where the effort was to really demonstrate that sanitation is something that requires both citizen ownership and state engagement, and that the whole notion of behavior change comes up front and center. In the months and years following that, wherever me and my colleagues traveled, we found that every single district, every single block, every single panchayat was talking about having to achieve sanitation targets. These targets were of course defined in terms of building toilets, but the rhetoric was also beginning to shift, and people started talking not just about the need to build toilets but also about the need to achieve open defecation free environments. So we felt that given this combination of change, it would be really interesting to try and see what's actually happening on the ground. And the two questions that we wanted to try and unravel, this is only the first step to what is a longer process. One was, what does high-powered political focus do to the capability of what we know is a fairly broken administrative system to actually get things done? And the second was, how does a system that isn't quite designed to do complicated things like behavior change actually respond to a program that, at least in its political rhetoric, seems to focus on the idea of behavior change? And the first step to that was really just to understand what's happening on the ground. And so we did a survey in December of last year where we and I'll go into all of those details in a bit, where we went to about 7,500 households in 10 districts in the country just to try and see what's actually happening on the ground in terms of how the Swachh Bharat Rural is being implemented. The first insight we got before I launch into the data came just from the process of trying to understand what questions we should be asking on the ground. if you talk to some people in the sanitation ministry in Delhi, they will tell you what most people who've been working in the behavior change elements of sanitation swear by. It's the Kool-Aid that I drank when I was at the Waters and Sanitation program. That the way to achieve open defecation, the way to achieve true sanitation is not through an emphasis on toilet construction, but through an emphasis on open defecation free. So open defecation free ought to be the target. And the role of the central government in all of this is not to define what tightly controlled steps you ought to take in achieving that, but to leave it to the innovation and capability on the ground, particularly at the grassroots level, at the panchayat level, to figure it out. And our job is to facilitate innovation and to track that once the process of achieving open defecation and the process of sustaining open defecation. Toilet construction through subsidies is not the emphasis of this program, is one voice. So we started looking carefully at the guidelines. And although this is front and center in the guidelines of the Swachh Bharat Mission Gramin also quite clearly states that there will be a subsidy of somewhere between 10 to...
Gramin?
Rural.
Okay, so it's a rural component of Swachh.
There's a rural component, there's an urban component. The two have very different, some elements of them of it are quite different and the problems are quite different. So also the line ministries are different. Department of Drinking Water and Sanitation is under the umbrella of the Ministry of Rural Development. Urban Sanitation is handled by the Urban Ministry, and Health is handled by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. So you already have your first problem of trying to achieve a public health, solve a public health problem with three different departments, none of which come together in any way. So the guidelines give you a subsidy. The states are given targets. If you go to the Swachh Bharat Mission website, management information system that the government is very, very proud of, the first thing that you see is a number that flashes telling you the number of toilets that have been constructed. And in fact, even in the 10 minutes while Ila, you were speaking, I had gone to the MIS website, and the numbers had gone up from 33 to 39 within the 10 minutes. Clearly the rhetoric being what the rhetoric is, the system is very much designed to focus on this achievement of toilet construction. And if you start looking at the budget, 97% of the Swachh Bharat Mission expenditure in 2015-16 was on individual household toilet construction, which is done through the provision of this subsidy. So there is a complete mismatch just on paper between the rhetoric of how the program is being imagined in the minds of some of those who are leading the program sitting in Delhi and the actual guidelines that they have set for themselves. And when you start talking to people on the ground, even though the rhetoric is that the target of the program is now open defecation free, and the Prime Minister has stated that he hopes that every district in the country will achieve open defecation free by the 31st of March or something like that, really the pathway to getting to open defecation free is by constructing toilets. So the big question that we had is, what really do we study? And so we figured we'll just try and map the process. So how did households that have built toilets actually gone about the process of building toilets, and do they actually use them? Those were the two main things that we sought to answer. So just to give you a brief background on what the survey, just the sample of the survey, we had 7,500 households that we surveyed in three villages across 10 districts in five states. These states included Himachal Pradesh, Rajasthan, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, Bihar. There was no particular scientific reason why we identified the specific states that we did. We went to these states because we've been working here for years and we have teams that know how to mobilize people and do quick surveys. But it did just by chance happen from a sanitation perspective to be a very interesting choice of states. Himachal Pradesh and Maharashtra have traditionally been far better in terms of achieving sanitation. Maharashtra was a sort of pioneer of the implementing the community-led total sanitation movement in India in the late 1990s, and on any given indicator that tracks sanitation does significantly well, so does Himachal Pradesh. They had in fact accelerated their attempts at reaching open defecation free in the early to mid 2000s. And so these are relatively good states, whereas Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, and in particular Bihar are the wild, wild west when it comes to sanitation. So you get a really good comparison. We have districts that are, we also happened in our sample to have two interesting districts, Jhalawar, which is a chief minister's district of a BJP chief minister in Rajasthan. So one would assume that you'd see some good numbers there. And Nalanda, which is the chief minister of Bihar's district as well. So we were curious also to see whether we will, given this choice of districts, get some interesting results. The first thing that we wanted to do when we thought about how to sample households was that we would go to the government's management information system, pull out their list of achievement. So they have a list which goes, it's very granular, goes all the way down to the particular household that has built a toilet, and that we would trace those households and then track the process of how the households sort of achieved sanitation according to the government over the period starting from 2014 to December 2015 when we did the survey. But we discovered that, in fact, that was quite difficult to do, and I'll come to that in a second. And so we had to go back to the drawing board. We could find people whose names were on those achievement lists. And at some point when we were piloting, we realized that it's not really worth our while to continue along this path. And so we created two types of samples. In every village that we went to, we identified five households whose names actually appeared in the achievement list. And the remainder households were households that we randomly sampled, so they may or may not actually have toilets. So it sort of became not just a survey about the state of Swachh Bharat implementation, but also a state of sanitation more broadly. So let me first begin by telling you what's actually happening as far as the government's own perspective on its program, government's own reporting on its program. This is not going to come as a surprise to anybody in this room. The quality of government databases are poor, to say the least. Some of the less egregious problems was definition of villages doesn't always match either with census or the local government directory. So finding the villages became difficult, finding the habitations became difficult, missing habitations, misclassified habitations. The usual stuff. And by the way, the ministry is really proud of its MIS. They have now created an app. You can get it on your phone. And to be fair to them, of everything else that we had to say, they said we don't understand anything. But when it came to the data gaps, they actually took that very, very seriously. And they seem to at least be attempting to try and clean that up. But nonetheless, this is what it looked like in 2015. And one of the consequences of us presenting this and making a bit of a noise about it over the last few weeks has been that these achievement lists have not disappeared from the MIS. So I don't know whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. The granularity of the achievement lists are gone. So this is just a sample to show you, it's not important, but just to give you a sense of what the duplicates are. You have duplicate Aadhaar numbers, you have duplicate ration card numbers, you have the same names. We looked at some, in the same village, the same family gets repeated again and again. There's also a category which we haven't shown you, which says whether they receive money or not, but it's not clear where that grant came from or what it was, and it goes on endlessly. So just knowing those numbers that are flashing on the government website, it's not clear who those numbers, what those numbers are and what they mean. But we did manage to find 1,500 people whose names actually featured in this list, spread across these 10 districts across the country. And so we assume that if you made it onto an achievement list, at minimum you'd have a toilet. Well, 29% of the households who made it on the achievement list, in fact, did not have toilets. And here's the interesting thing. States that did, you'd expect... You'd expect to see some good things in certain places, and the good news is that you do see those good things in those places. So Satara, which is the last bar on your right in Maharashtra, which is the home of Maharashtra's open defecation free movement, 99% of the names on the government's achievement list actually showed up. They actually did have toilets. Whereas Nalanda and Udaipur had the largest gaps between reported achievement and presence of toilets. So about 44% of the households that were on the list actually had toilets in Nalanda, and 46% of households that had on the achievement list that where you should have had 100% toilets had actually had toilets in Udaipur.
In Satara, weren't you already at near 100% achievement?
You were pretty much at near 100% achievement.
It's been a struggle for them to find the few blocks where you would be able to show them as achievements. Did you know that the achievement was a delta in the
Yeah. So there is, so because you see, the thing is that there's also, you can build a toilet and then it can, you can have a slip back, the toilet can become dysfunctional, unusable, and then you rebuild a toilet, and the achievement list actually doesn't capture that. So often they are so even if I've had a toilet in the past and for whatever reason I want to rebuild a toilet, I can show up in the achievement list, which is one of the reasons why there are gaps between what the Swachh Bharat MIS says and what the census says about toilet coverage. So 36% of the households that had toilets reported that those toilets were unusable. We defined unusable based on the household's own perception of what it meant to be unusable. So we asked, if you have a toilet, is the toilet usable by you? The percentage of usable toilets was unsurprisingly lowest in Udaipur and Nalanda, and therefore you see a significant amount of open defecation.
Did it become unusable over time?
There could be many reasons, but yes, it becomes unusable over time.
So that's a maintenance issue, or is that unusable because of the construction?
It's also the way it's been constructed, the way the pit has been constructed, and then the way the household has chosen to maintain it. It's a set of factors. We also assumed, at least that's what the database seemed to suggest, and that's what the state governments had seemed to suggest, if you show up in the achievement list, chances are that you have got some money from the government. So we asked households whether they had actually asked for money. So the way the Swachh Bharat is designed, and the previous Nirmal Bharat, you had a similar system. Once you built a toilet, you can put in a grant application for the subsidy. There's a photograph and an application that is handed over to the panchayat, which gets uploaded into a system, following which you're supposed to receive money. There were sharp state-wise differences between households who requested money and households who actually received money. Udaipur, Nalanda, you'd assume that these are places where most people want money. But only 18% households actually put in a request for money in Udaipur, 50% households put in a request for money in Nalanda. Once you put a request for money, there is no guarantee, unsurprisingly, that you will actually get this money. 60% of the households that requested for money received it, nearly 90% in Satara. So Satara has this, just it's a last mile problem. I have the number somewhere, I'll pull it out, of the number of households that still don't have toilets. But of those three or four households that wanted money, they put in requests, they got money, but only less than 40% in Jhalawar that wanted money actually received money. I'll now skip over to give you this I feel is important. In order to get the money, somebody from the government has to come and verify and monitor. And especially if you made it onto the achievement list, somebody really ought to have come and monitored, because there's no other way by which you would get into the achievement list. 62% of the households we surveyed reported being monitored. So we asked specifically whether somebody from the government or the panchayat came to look at the toilet. And again, there are significant gaps between districts. What's happening across? There has been a significant increase in the actual construction of toilets, and the good news is that this increase in the actual construction of toilets is happening in districts where it's needed the most. So there's a Satara number. According to the 2011 census, Satara had 70% toilet coverage. Kangra had 64% toilet coverage, Solan had 69% toilet coverage, and while they are constructing, obviously the pace of construction is not as high as in states, as in districts like Jhalawar, Purnia and Sagar. The interesting thing is that the average cost of toilets ranges from 15,000 to 40,000. The bulk of the toilets that were constructed in the 15 to 20,000 range were constructed in those districts where the panchayat has gone about constructing the toilet. So it's taken the government subsidy and constructed the toilets in households. This happens particularly in Madhya Pradesh. In other instances, households, at least by their own reporting, say that they are putting in about 40,000 rupees to construct toilets. Government subsidy is somewhere between 10 and 12,000. So there is a really interesting gap here, which plays into, I think, this larger question of how does one actually motivate toilet construction, that in India, people are not willing to construct and use low-cost toilets. The Bangladesh model, on which this whole open defecation free movement that is taking that is now being implemented in India is premised on the idea that You will want to do construct toilets, and you can, even the poorest people can construct toilets on their own because there are models for perfectly sanitary low cost toilets. But Indians don't seem to like that. And
how is this cost of toilet being calculated?
So it's been calculated. So we asked the household, but this question has been asked in multiple other surveys as well, and we cross verified, and we've all got a more or less fairly similar numbers. So therefore, it's not, while toilets are being constructed, they're not being constructed as fast, and they're certainly not being constructed on the basis of what the government has to offer. People are choosing to construct toilets where they are, and where they are only those who can afford to are actually constructing toilets. Interestingly, most of the toilets were constructed actually did so without government assistance. About 24% of the households that were constructed actually got money from the government. But and it's possible that this is because the government money flow is quite checkered. Here's a quick look at budgets. Most districts spent their money in 2015 and 16, but the bulk of this money was spent somewhere between January through March, and our survey was conducted in December. So it's possible that some of the households that we were talking with actually didn't get the money because the money hadn't yet been released from government. But given the cost of toilet construction, it would seem that whatever is happening out of people's own desire to construct toilets rather than out of any governmental intervention. And I also say this because when we started asking about the Swachh Bharat Mission itself, and this came to us as quite a surprise, because all the noise that is being made, every village you visit has something written on the panchayat walls about the Swachh Bharat Mission, and the Gandhi spectacles are all over, and Vidya Balan is everywhere, and we would assume that everybody would know about the Swachh Bharat. The data I haven't put here, we asked, are you aware of the Swachh Bharat Mission itself? The numbers were really low, but we didn't push that because we assume that maybe people don't know the name of a program, but they are aware that something is going on. There's a whole set of things that state governments are supposed to do, and by and large, most households didn't know about those. Every state government is supposed to appoint a Swachhta Doot in every village, which would do the job of, say, an Anganwadi worker, go house to house, mobilize, tell people about the need for toilet construction and for sanitation. Only 6% of the households that we surveyed knew about the Swachhta Doot. Every village is supposed to have a Panchayat Samiti, that is basically the point, place at which all the open defecation free awareness raising programs are supposed to be implemented. Only 10% knew about it. Only 10% had actually had any knowledge of an awareness program on Swachhta in the village. So much for all the noise that is being created around behavior change. Just in terms of tangible activity that seems to be happening across the country, there doesn't seem to be much. And again, this won't be too surprising, because if you look at the expenditure, you get a really good sense. As I mentioned, in 2015-16, 97% of government expenditure was on individual household construction, latrine construction. There is supposed to be 8% of the budget is supposed to be spent on IEC, which is basically the line item for all information and awareness related activities. Bihar spent 0 in 14-15, spent 1% in 15-16. And look at Himachal Pradesh, that recently just declared itself open defecation free. Even they only spent 15% of their awareness related funds to conduct awareness related activities. So the noise is interesting, but the action on the ground seems to be quite missing. And again, none of this is particularly surprising, because we have lots of programs and we don't see much action on the ground. But to me, what's interesting about sanitation is, given the kind of political focus the program has, given the kind of emphasis that every single district and block office right now is only working on achieving open defecation free targets, the fact that the state is broken on the ground still remains a very, very serious constraint, and it isn't able to pull itself together, particularly for very difficult things like this. One of the reasons why these IEC activities don't get spent is because it requires very serious innovative thinking on the ground, and the district collectors are reliant on an army of junior engineers who are meant to implement this total sanitation campaign, which is also part of an implementation issue. The drinking water departments, and in some states the public health and engineering departments, are in charge of implementing rural sanitation. This is basically a cohort of junior engineers. Junior engineers know the basics of how you construct a toilet. They will be able to tell you the details of how you get your septic tank right. But if you ask them to start building a public health related campaign to arrive at why it's important to use toilets and deal with complicated things like social change, they aren't going to be competent because they are engineers. They're not supposed to. There's a reason you don't see engineers in advertising firms. And the health ministry has a completely different arm with the Anganwadi, with the Ashas, who might potentially be a useful link to this whole public health narrative, but they aren't part of this story at all. And just to make things even more complicated, basic civic services are supposed to be the job of the panchayats, who have been given absolutely no money for street cleaning and for sewage and garbage disposal, etc. So you have all these multiple verticals operating on a whole range of different things, none of which come together. But there is some ambition of arriving at some open defecation free target. And the government of India has created a very interesting set of indicators of how you monitor open defecation free, which includes all of these different things. So it's great to be able to monitor this too, but you also have to have some set of coordination and capability on the ground to be able to implement all of these things. And so when it comes to IEC, here are some examples of what's happening. The district collector of Solan, after the state capital, the chief minister decided to make sure that Himachal Pradesh becomes an open defecation free state before Kerala declares that it is an open defecation free state, issued a district order saying that every household that hasn't actually built a toilet will have their ration will be cut, their electricity will be cut, and their water supply will be cut. In other places that we have visited, there is the district collectors, because now it's very savvy to talk about it, are talking about how to use social media to convince people to use toilets. But the focus of this entire campaign, the reason why governments should be involved in telling people how to do something that is pretty private, is because of the public health consequences. What we have managed to do is to shift the target from constructing toilets to the target of achieving open defecation free, but toilets still remain at the center. So the means to become an open defecation free village is to construct toilets and somehow push people into those toilets. But building this entire ecosystem around to be able to convince people that using toilets is a matter of public health and will reduce diarrhea and improve everybody's lives, that is not yet anywhere in the front and center of this entire campaign, and so it suffers from all the anomalies that most government programs have. And what makes it even more dangerous is because it's so target driven and the targets are so unrealistic in the context of the realities in which we operate, you have rather miserable data entry officers sitting in closed offices putting in numbers that don't make any sense. And just as a last anecdote before I close, days before Himachal Pradesh declared itself open defecation free, one of the MIS officers said, well, there's nothing I can do. So he just changed the Excel columns, and he happily told our researcher that that's what I did. And if I were that person, I would probably do the same thing. Thanks.